tips, colleagues. Good morning. First of all, I'm just really pleased to be here today to officially open the National Rare Disease Office. I know it's taken a lot of time, a lot of work together, and some degree of frustration, but it is good that we are here today. I believe it's a very significant and positive development for the treatment of rare diseases in Ireland. And the opening of this new National Rare Diseases Office is good news for patients, good news for their families, for their carers, for healthcare professionals, and for researchers alike. The health service in Ireland is going through a period of change. We're moving from a very difficult period of retrenchment to one of regrowth and expansion. We're shifting the emphasis away from hospitals to primary community care. We're making the first steps towards universal healthcare with the over 60s and over 70s coming into reality next month. And also there's a renewed focus on being healthy, staying healthy, and coping with chronic diseases, including rare diseases. We know that there's a very large number of rare diseases, somewhere between 5,000 and 8,000, and of course they vary from diseases that aren't that rare at all, like cystic fibrosis and hemophilia, for example, to ones that are very rare and may only have one patient or two patients here in Ireland. But when you take all of those together, rare diseases affect millions of citizens across Europe and hundreds of thousands here in Ireland. I understand the challenges that many of these patients have to endure. At the start of their journey, patients can find it very hard to get an accurate diagnosis or even a diagnosis at all. And that's often due to the lack of expertise or knowledge about a particular condition. They may also get delays in getting appropriate treatment for the exact same reasons. And often the treatment is not available in Ireland due to the rarity of the disease. And we also know, and many of us have met patients with rare diseases, and of course we know that generally they become the real experts in the disease. And certainly my experience was that they knew more about their condition than I did, which always put me at an enormous disadvantage as a GP in trying to give them advice. But I think it's important that we recognise that as an asset, the fact that people know so much about their condition and that we involve them more in their care, much more so than we would with somebody who perhaps has a more common disease. From time to time, it's been widely accepted that we need a global approach to improve services for people affected, and we need to pool knowledge and expertise across countries, particularly here in Europe. Fortunately, the European Union is very active in this area, and Ireland is playing a key role. And our first National Rare Disease Plan acknowledges many of the challenges that face patients and their families, and gives us a roadmap for the prevention, diagnosis, and treatment of rare diseases and conditions in the future. As you know, we followed on from the work of the European Council, which acknowledged the scarcity of knowledge and expertise in the field of rare disease. The National Plan, published by my forebear, Mr. Riley, a year ago, made 48 recommendations. I should say 48 recommendations, never a good place to start in my view, but nonetheless there are 48. They do cover a number of important themes: information and research, prevention, diagnosis and treatment, access to appropriate medicines, and also support for patients, families, and carers. HSC has established a national clinical program for rare disease, and that's a joint initiative between HSC and the RCPI, and I really want to thank both HSC and the Royal College of Physicians for their involvement in it. And it aims to improve timely diagnosis, care and expertise. It will also implement other recommendations set out in the plan, such as identifying national centres of expertise for rare disease, and also helping them to take part in European networks for specific rare diseases. These networks, known as European Reference Networks, are the best opportunity for us to get access to international expertise. A clinical lead has been appointed, supported by a clinical advisory group comprising both professionals and patient representatives. The clinical program director separately is setting up a group to look at how we can better access orphan drugs. Meanwhile, research on rare diseases has benefited from about 7 million in allocations from the Health Research Board since 2010. Work is also planned to code rare diseases in our health information system, and that will allow us to know better how many rare diseases are being diagnosed and managed in our health service. It's something which we don't know enough about at the moment, but need to know. In new national oversight group has been established by my department, and that's made up of patient reps, the health research boards, the HSC, and also department officials. And its job is to monitor and oversee the implementation of the recommendations set out in the national plan. The plan recommends the setting up of an Irish team to coordinate activity on Orphanet, which is an encyclopedia of rare diseases and other information available worldwide. And this local team will provide accurate information about specialised clinics, treatments, medical laboratories, registries, and clinical trials, and access and making information easily accessible to patients. It's my expectation that the office will act as a national point of reference for inquiries about services, diagnostics, and clinical trials. And it'll also have a helpline function, and over time will develop a role in emergency surveillance. And helpline will start in September. Its work will be led by a consultant geneticist, supported by a genetics counsellor, and also an administrative officer as well. The allocation from the HSC to set up the office this year is of course under the auspices of Mater Hospital, but will move to the new Children's Hospital in a few years' time. The European Commission has also agreed to part fund the post information science staff for the office, and the office will also be crucial in building a national picture of rare disease and guiding future policies. I'm conscious that since I become minister, this I think is my fourth, perhaps fifth visit to the Mater Hospital. So I do particularly want to recognise the enormous contribution that this hospital has made to healthcare, and also the Sisters of Mercy have made to healthcare in Ireland down the years. The Mater is a national centre for quite a number of specialties. I think it's appropriate that the National Rare Disease Office is being incubated here, as I said. I also know that there's some anxiety amongst the pathology hospitals about their future in the new healthcare infrastructure, particularly the hospital groups. So allow me just to say, as a politician, and also as a doctor trained as an undergraduate and postgraduate, mostly in voluntary hospitals, that I value their heritage, their ethos, their demonstrated capacity for research and innovation, their ability to raise funds independently, to contribute to education, and also their autonomy. And certainly for as long as they can, as long as their owners wish, I think the voluntary should continue to retain their own legal personality and boards. If anything, I foresee the voluntaries leading the hospital groups rather than being swallowed up by them. And hospital groups, of course, are about more autonomy at hospital level, not less. And I think as hospital groups develop, they can learn a lot about how to do things well, and not least Ireland East learning from the Mater, as evinces, on how to do things well across the group. That's not to say, however, that voluntary hospitals are perfect. They can report into the governance of TALA, the PAC investigation into the financial affairs at the Central Medial Clinic, and also the historic legacy of our native Lourdes and Drogheda are nothing to celebrate. And of course, any body that's dependent on taxpayers' money for its existence needs to respect government policy and treat all citizens equally. The hospital groups will develop further in the next year or so, and we hope to give them legal status in an interim form this year. We've seen a good example of hospital groups working already in the fact that the Coombe has taken over governance of maternity services in Portlaoise and has made them safer and sustainable into the future. And we'll hope to publish by the end of the year the legislation to establish on a statutory footing the Children's Hospital Group, so that the three children's hospitals in Dublin are integrated before they move to the new building. And I really welcome the input with the Pathology Hospital Forum and others into developing that legislation. As for this office, I see it as being a focal point for rare disease, building up information and expertise on treatment and services nationally and also internationally. I'd also like to mention the North-South Convention. Officials from both Northern Ireland and Ireland have met a number of occasions to discuss our respective plans for rare disease. I'm told those meetings have been very, very positive and very helpful, and have also deepened cross-border cooperation in the area. I'm keen to see this cooperation continue, and I want to see all avenues being explored to deepen that relationship north and south. Finally, I want to wish the National Rare Disease Office the very best as it begins its work. I know that it's going to make a big difference in the lives of patients with rare diseases in the years to come, and also for their families, for their doctors.
would like